if you would stand and sing. If you want to grab a hymn book, we're going to be in page 547, the first one, as I Stand Amazed.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned unclean.
Good morning. Happy New Year. Turn with me in your Bibles, please, to the book of Romans, chapter 6. Romans chapter 6. As you turn to Romans chapter 6, can all of you just take a quick second and just turn around and look at our tech guys back there and say a big thank you? Thank you, guys. You guys are some of my heroes. We're going to pick up in the book of Romans right where we left off, Romans chapter 6. The title of the message today is No Middle Ground. No Middle Ground. How many of you grew up in a house that had a den and also had a living room? All right, so the house that I grew up in just had a den, but I remember my grandma's house, she had a den in a living room, and I had to look to make sure she wasn't watching every time I went into the living room, because the living room, you weren't really supposed to go in. In fact, the only time that we ever went in there as a family was at Christmas, okay? And it was such a big deal at Meemaw's house to go into the living room at Christmas. I think that some of us kind of treat God like a living room, okay? Most of our living is done outside of Him. Not everyone, obviously, but often as Christians. And we go into the living room of God on occasion. But I want to tell you something. As we face 2022, God doesn't want to be our living room. He wants to be the place where we live and do life. Okay, and I'm really excited about that. Some of you have heard of this before. If not, you'll get a chuckle out of it. A pig said to a chicken, "What shall we have for breakfast?" The chicken suggested, "Let's have ham and eggs." The pig said, "Oh no, not ham." Well, the chicken replied, "Well, why not? I'll furnish the eggs and you the ham." The pig then said, "Well, for you it's involvement, but for me it's total commitment." I want to tell you something. You know what God wants from us in 2022? He wants total commitment. He wants total commitment. I want to say a hearty welcome to you all here in this room. A hearty welcome to those who are sitting in the parking lot. If you're in the parking lot, give us a big loud beep so we can hear it. And I've already been told that there's quite a number that are watching online. Please, please be in prayer for the number of people that are sick right now. So I know that many are watching, but for us in this room, it's kind of cozy in here, isn't it? No middle ground in 2022. You know, we've reached a time in the history of the church today where I think that we observe a large gray area when it comes to Christian living. And as I think about the culture that my son will grow up in, my primary concern is not really that Jesus or his followers will be accepted. That's not really what I'm concerned about. My primary concern about the culture that my son grows up in, if we're still here then, is that genuine Christianity will be observed in Christ's followers. My main concern, that genuine Christianity will be observed in Christ's followers. As Christians, I think that you would agree with me that we need to have an unapologetic allegiance to Jesus and the Word of God. Amen? No apologies for what the Bible says and the ramifications of what the Bible says. And as we pledge allegiance to Jesus in 2022, and we take the Bible in heart and in hand, we allow ourselves to be changed, and then we are to go out and engage our world with the truth that we find in God's Word. Our approach as Christians should always be that of love and humility. Amen? Of love and humility. Yet we need to be filled with fire and with light. Amen? And therein lies the balance. Love and humility coupled with fire and light. And if God can accomplish that in us, then we will well be on our way to engaging our world as we live successfully for Jesus in 2022. But you know what? Here's the bottom line. Here's the truth. As we live and engage, the temptation will come, it always comes, to give ground on things that matter to God. You know, Christians can be among the nicest of God's people, but sometimes we are nice to a fault. And in that, sometimes we give ground on things that matter to God when we should never give ground on things that matter to God. Sin creeps in. And before we know it, in our Christian lives, because sin has crept in, we run away from God, like Adam and Eve did in the garden. God doesn't want that to happen in our lives. He doesn't want the sin to creep in. He wants us to live in such a way that whenever we hear the voice of our Father calling to us, we don't run away from Him, but we run to Him. Amen? Because we long to be with Him, to be around those that love Him. God is calling us in 2022 to be change agents in our culture. And that begins whenever the church, made up of you and me, whenever we realize that our primary allegiance is to Jesus, and we understand what God wants us to really get a hold of today, that in the Christian life, there is no middle ground. In the Christian life, there is no middle ground. And if we're going to see that today in Romans chapter 6, then the first thing that we need to take a look at is the reality of ownership. The reality of ownership. We're in Romans chapter 6. We left off last time in verse 14. We'll pick right back up there. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. Does that sound like a request? Does that sound like an option? Or does that sound like the normal for genuine Christian living? To me, it sounds like the normal. It's the expectation. It should be the reality. For sin shall not have dominion over you, because you're not under law, but you're under grace. Let's pray together. Deacon Seal, will you ask the Lord to bless our time in the Word of God today? Amen. Thank you. Sin shall not lord itself over you. It shall not reign as Lord over your life as it once did. Did you know that it's not God's will for sin to be our master? And sin doesn't have to be our master. Now, the law was given so that humankind would understand what sin is. It's also stated in the Word of God that the power of sin is found in the law. What Paul is basically saying to his readers is this: if you're still trying to please God through good works, then sin would still be your master. But you're not under law any longer, you're under grace. You see, sin and law tend to go together. 1 Corinthians 15:56, the sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. Romans 7:12 says, therefore the law is holy, and the commandment holy and just and good. Has then what is good become death to me? Certainly not. But sin, that it would be revealed as sin, was producing death in me through what is good. Speaking of the law, so that sin through the commandment might become exceedingly sinful. For we know that the law is spiritual, but there's a problem. I'm carnal. The law is spiritual, I'm carnal, and sold under sin. See, the law brings with it a curse to the unredeemed heart. When you take away law and you add God's grace into the equation, here's what happens. Sin is robbed of its strength, and you become able to please God. But there's another issue. Can we toy with sin as Christians? Is that okay for us to do that, to be that way? Well, take a look at verse 15. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? What does your Bible say? What's the next phrase? God forbid. Certainly not. Let it not be so. Perish the thought would be another way to put it. Shall we sin because we are not under law but under grace? No. You know, the question that Paul asks here is actually very similar to the one that he asked in verse 1. In that verse, Paul asks, shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? Shall we continue living an unsaved, sinful lifestyle so that grace can increase? The question here that he asks basically is, shall we indulge in sin now again if we want to? Is that okay for the Christian to do that? Okay, we're not talking about all the time. Is it okay as Christians for us to just take a day off now and again from the Christian life? Is that okay? Well, certainly not. By no means. Is it okay if I take a Christian vacation? I'm not talking about going on a Gaither cruise. I'm talking about taking a vacation from being a Christian. Is it okay for us to just take like a time out and just say, you know what, I want to go sow some wild oats? Is that okay? Certainly not. God forbid. That's not how it's supposed to be. And so Paul comes back with another question. Look at verse 16. Do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are that one slaves whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to righteousness? So the question is this: are you a slave of sin or are you a slave of Jesus? Which one is it? Which one is it that you call your master? Which one is it that you submit yourself to? He says, don't you know? In other words, isn't it obvious that there is no gray area in the Christian life? There is no middle ground here? You're either a slave to sin and to evil, or you are a slave to the obedience of Jesus Christ. This was at the heart of what Jesus meant whenever he uttered these words. No one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he'll be loyal to the one or cling to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. You cannot serve God and something else. Now, the word slave here is the Greek word doulos, which means a bondservant or a willing slave. Now, being a slave to sin brings something with it. It brings with it spiritual death, physical death, and eternal death. Spiritual death, physical death, and in the end, second death or eternal death. Being a slave to the obedience of Christ's gospel leads to righteousness. You see, death is the natural result of sin. Sin, when it's finished with someone, brings forth death. Those three deaths, okay, that I just described. Righteousness is the natural consequence of obeying God in salvation and beyond. But you know, Paul does something amazing here. He stops and he takes a look away from this and he begins praising God. Let's take a look at the reasons for praise in verse 17. But God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered. At this point, Paul praises God because these Romans accepted the gospel. They received it. They were saved. They were slaves to sin, but inwardly, out of the heart, and by the way, wholeheartedly, they obeyed that form of doctrine to which they had been delivered by God. Now, the word form here refers to a mold that a craftsman would pour molten metal into. And here's the picture. God pours his new children into the mold of his divine truth. That's why Christians have an overwhelming desire to know God and to experience in God. All I can do is bear you testimony of my experience, okay? You can't argue with someone's experience. Here's what happened. I was headed nowhere in my life. I've told you this many times. I failed the 12th grade twice, okay? And I was heading absolutely nowhere. And God came out of nowhere and saved my soul. And I want to tell you something. Everything changed after that. Everything. My friends changed. My desires changed. My want to changed. My everything changed. You see, I died to that old life. And I was risen in Christ to a new life. And I have not been perfect. I have definitely made my mistakes. But I do want to tell you this. I have never looked back. You know why? Because once Jesus Christ gets a hold of your life, you kiss the world goodbye. And all the attractions of the world and everything that used to be sacred to us, we now count as dung. We were all once molded according to the pattern of this world's system in our lives. But you know what happened at the moment that you trusted Jesus as personal Lord and Savior? God took that worldly mold and he broke it into pieces. And he took you and he melted you down and he poured you into his mold. And you now have a new master. Take a look at verse 18. And having been set free from sin, you became slaves of righteousness. Now, you have to understand, whenever we interpret Scripture, we always ask the question, what did God mean to who he wrote it, when he wrote it? And the thing that you need to understand about the Roman culture was slavery was a reality. And so when Paul speaks in these terms, his listeners, his readers know exactly what he's talking about. They get the picture. These Christians are people that heard the word of God. They committed their souls and their lives to the truth that they heard, and the result was that they were set free from their sin and they became a doulos, or douloi, plural. They became slaves of righteousness. You see, it doesn't fit. It doesn't measure up for a child of God who has passed from death to life to be enslaved to sin. It doesn't work. That's not the way that it's designed. And by the way, it doesn't have to be that way. Why would someone who's been set free from the slavery of sin ever want to return to that slavery? and take it upon themselves. If you have been set free from the prison cell, why would you ever want to go lock yourself up again? Look at verse 19. I speak in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you presented your members as slaves of uncleanness and of lawlessness, leading to more lawlessness, so now, just as that is what you did, so now present your body parts, your members, as slaves of righteousness for the sake of holiness. You know what? We need to have some excitement over our service for Jesus in 2022. Amen? Amen. The term slavery, it does accurately describe a lost person's relationship with sin and also to Satan. I don't know if you've ever faced any type of addiction, but addiction to sin is like a shark that smells blood in the water. Okay? Soon it becomes like a feeding frenzy in someone's life where the feeding is out of control. Slavery to God is not really the phrase that Paul wants to use here. In fact, he almost apologizes for using it. But he gives this illustration because the spiritual understanding of the Roman Christians was weak. God doesn't hold his children in bondage, but Paul uses it to make the point. There has been a reversal. There has been a complete change of allegiance in the life of a Christian. There's been a complete change of lordship. When someone is in an unsaved state, and they are completely spiritually dead, and they're lost, who is their Lord? Sin, the world, the devil. And they are in bondage to what we would call the world system. God doesn't hold his children in bondage, but there has been a change of allegiance. We were slaves of the evil one, but now we become a willing slave of the Lord Jesus Christ. Here's the point. The unsaved used their bodies to serve evil and wickedness. But now they were willing slaves of Jesus. Now that they were free, the Apostle Paul is urging them to yield their body parts to sin, from sin to righteousness. And when someone does that, whenever they realize, I used to be in bondage over here, but I've been set free. I used to use my body to serve sin, but now, since I've been set free, I'm going to use my body to serve God and to serve righteousness and holiness. That's the idea. And whenever we do that, whenever that change of allegiance is clear, you begin to understand that there is no room for middle ground. There's no room in the Christian life to serve God and the flesh. It just can't happen. Well, Pastor, so what? Let me ask you a question. How many of you, we don't glory in this, okay? But how many of you in your younger days sowed some wild oats? Okay, you don't have to answer out loud. Just look at me. How many of you sowed some wild oats? Okay. You know what the Apostle Paul is saying? He's saying, just as you got excited about sinning, get excited about yielding to the Lord. Just as you were zealous in serving yourself and serving the flesh, be zealous, more zealous about serving God. Be a better saint than you were a sinner, is what he's saying. Verse 20, for when you were slaves of sin, you were free in regard to righteousness. Oh man, I think about the prodigal here. Would you agree that the unsaved person is free? Well, we just said that they were slaves to sin, but they are free in one regard. They are free when it comes to righteousness. You know why? Because they don't have any. And they cannot produce it. At least, not the type of righteousness that we talk about as Christians. The deeper that the unsaved person goes in his or her life of sin, the harder it gets for them to ever do right. Now, let's talk about the prodigal that Jesus mentions in the Word of God. When the prodigal was at home, he decided to leave and to enjoy himself out in the world. And his rebellion led him deeper and deeper into slavery. He had wrong desires that led to wrong deeds. And then he found himself in a place where he was completely jealous of pig slop. That's the end result of loose living for a Christian, of prodigal living, of going back into the world and walking just like, what was that dude's name from the Andy Griffith show? Otis? Remember Otis? How he loved to come and spend, I guess, Saturday night or Friday night or whatever in the jail cell. When the prodigal left, he wanted freedom, but you know what? He wound up in terrible slavery. See, the young prodigal wanted to have it all. He wanted to enjoy being a Christian, but also enjoy the flesh. He enjoyed his eternal security, okay? But he wanted to go out and live like the world. He enjoyed what he considered to be his ticket into heaven, but he wanted to go out and just live like hell. What he wanted. He wanted the world and faith. He compromised. He ruined his life, and he ended up in a pigsty. But you know what? God worked in his heart. And you know what happened? He had to make a complete surrender, and he received the grace of God to start over and to begin again. When he returned home, he yielded to God, he yielded to the Father, and he found true freedom. You know, if the prodigal could speak to you right now, you know what he'd tell you? He'd tell you in the Christian life, there is no middle ground. There is none. Third, let's take a look at the resulting fruit. There's fruit involved when it comes to the way that we live. There's the fruit of death. Verse 21. What fruit did you have then in the things of which you are now ashamed? For the end of those things is death. Yeah, that's a good question. Living that way, living an evil lifestyle, what did it do for you? Okay, what's the fruit? Well, the fruit of being enslaved is that it produces things in the life of a believer that causes them to be ashamed. And you know what? The things that you do cannot be undone. The things that you say you cannot take back. The reputation that you develop for yourself will take a long time to remedy. The end result of that type of living is death. But saving faith reverses this. The individual is set free, and the fruit of that freedom is holiness and a clean life. Look at verse 22. But now, having been set free from sin and having become slaves of God, you have your fruit to holiness and the end, everlasting life. The fruit of the salvation that you enjoy as a genuine child of God is the ability to be holy. You could not be holy while you were spiritually dead. But the life that you now enjoy should be a life of unhypocritical, liberated, genuine holiness. That should characterize the life of every child of God. I didn't say perfectly, but it should characterize your life. And then we arrive at a verse that we often use in personal work, verse 23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word wage here is often used in referring to a soldier's pay. The paycheck, the wage, The final result of sin is death. But the final result of the gift of God is life eternal. The word gift here is actually the word charisma, which means a grace gift. So here you have two contrasts, two sets of contrasts in the Bible. You have wages versus gifts, and you have eternal death versus eternal life. Pastor Steve, what does this mean to me? What is it that God wants me to see today from His Word in Romans 6? How's this going to help me in the new year? Here's how. If you're here and God has shown you that you were enslaved by sin, Jesus will set you free from that sin today. And you can begin a relationship with Him today. Or you could reject Him today and remain spiritually dead, and you will receive the proper wage. And the proper paycheck for your sin is eternal damnation. And for those who enter into eternal damnation, I want you to understand something. They've earned it. They will receive the paycheck that they've earned. And if that has got your attention this morning, and you say, you know what? I don't want to experience eternal damnation. I don't want to be a slave to sin anymore. But I realize that Jesus died on the cross for me to set me free so that I don't have to be a slave to sin and to serve it as my master anymore. I want to be set free. Set free to live for Jesus. I want a new master. I don't want to live the life I've lived, but I want to be given a new life. I want eternal life. If that's you and that's your desire today, then repent of your sin, of your life of sin, and ask Jesus to save your soul. The Bible says, ask and you shall receive. Whoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But you know what? I realize that I don't know who's saved in here or who's not. Okay? There are many gifted actors in the local church. Okay? There are many people that have fooled themselves into thinking that they have eternal life whenever they are as lost as Adolf Hitler. Okay? But if you're here today and you know that you're saved, if you are a genuine child of God, then your life will line up with your calling. And if your life does not line up with your calling and you're genuinely saved, then you should expect the Father to chasten you, because He chastens those that He loves. You know, there's a danger that we find that does not get preached on enough, and I feel like I should share it with you. As much as you may want to travel the middle road, and as much as you may want to enjoy that middle ground, you'll find that you can't. You know why? Because the road of the Christian life is too narrow. It's like jumping around on a balance beam. You will inevitably fall off because you can't do it. There is a possibility for the Christian to backslide and continue in that state until God shelves you. What does that mean, Pastor Steve? It basically means that in the Christian life, you can become so backslidden that God will basically take you on a shelf and He's done with you in this life. Okay? And He's not going to use you anymore. Pastor Steve, that's kind of scary. It's meant to be. It's meant to be. You can be shelved as a Christian. You can also suffer spiritual shipwreck as a Christian. Paul speaks to that. Or God can just kill you. Oh, Pastor Steve, that's not very positive this morning. Nevertheless, it is true. God can simply just take you out, just take you on home, and say, you know what? I'm not going to let you drag my name to the mud any longer. My testimony matters. Okay? Yes, you're my child, but I'm going to take you on to heaven. Okay? Hebrews 6, 4 through 6 speaks of that. There are people that can genuinely be saved, but they can pass a point of no return in the Christian life. 1 Timothy 1:19, having faith and a good conscience, which some having rejected concerning the faith have suffered shipwreck, been smashed on the rocks. 1 Corinthians 11:30, for this reason many are weak and sick among you, and many have died. And then the Bible also speaks about a sin unto death. You know, there's a Chinese proverb. It jumped out at me. If you want to know what water is, if you want to know what water is like, don't ask a fish. If you want to know what water is like, don't ask a fish. Why? Why wouldn't we ask a fish? Well, because it's all that he knows. He is always immersed in it. Fish do not know that they're wet. You know, we are immersed in a secular and sin-sick culture. But I want you to know something. Whenever God saves a person, again, I bear you my own testimony. This was true in my life. When God saves a person, they automatically realize that they're wet. Okay? They automatically realize, oh my goodness, everything is new. I don't want to be a part of this anymore. I want to be a part of this. I want to tell you, I didn't have to say to my unsaved friends, I don't want to hang out with you anymore. I didn't have a choice. They did not hang out with me anymore. They stopped. And at first, when it came to the little church that I got saved in a little Free Will Baptist church in Raleigh. Some of them may be watching this, so I'm going to be careful what I say. There were a lot of older people in the church, okay? Nothing wrong with older people, but there wasn't a whole lot of people my age. But you know what? I didn't care. I wanted to be around those people that I considered to be hokey, okay? Because I knew that they loved Jesus just like I did, and I knew that they loved me, and they took me in, and they loved on me. And I wanted, if the doors were going to be open, I wanted to go through them. I wanted to be there, because I wanted to be with God's people. We're immersed in a sick culture. But when God saves a person, they realize that they've been translated out of that, and they've been put into something that's new, the kingdom of light. Christian, if you're not careful, you can get totally immersed again in the unsaved world around you, and you can begin living like the unsaved. But the discerning Christian will recognize in you that you're drifting. The discerning Christian will confront you in your sin and say, you know what, you don't need to go down that road. Jesus loves you. But you know what we do in our sin? We want to tune him out. We want to tune the Holy Spirit out, because once we start going down that road, we don't want an intervention. We don't want people to confront us. You know why? Because we want to sin. But the loving Christian is his brother's keeper. And sometimes Christians just need to get slapped around a little bit by the Holy Spirit that fills believers. I don't know of a nicer way to put it. Christian, there's a very easy way to avoid what we're talking about today. Number one, know that you have been crucified with Christ and that you have died to sin. And because you have died to sin, it no longer is your master. Number two, it's not enough just to know that. You have to move beyond that knowledge, and you have to reckon yourself, consider yourself to be dead. I know that I've died. Now put that knowledge into practice in your life and live that way. Reckon yourself to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to whom? Alive to God. And number three, yield your body to His glory. When God is at work in someone's life, they will see the positive difference in you if you're living for Jesus. You know, the world is filled with Christians who want to play around with sin, and we see the effects of this everywhere. But in the service of Jesus Christ in 2022, there is no middle ground. Amen? There's no middle ground. Here's my question to you, and it's very simple. Are you all in with Jesus in this new year? Are you all in with Him? I want to close with this. You know, sometimes in the Christian life, it's tough to stay focused. It's tough to live a focused Christian life. The story writer says, from every direction, something or someone clamors for our attention. A distraction draws our eyes, and the next thing we know, we've swerved off the road and are headed down another detour. There was a Chicago youth pastor. He came up with a very clever way to keep his group on track. He was concerned that the balmy beaches of Florida, which were the site of their upcoming evangelism trip, would lure the teens away from their purpose. So he fashioned a cross from two pieces of lumber. It was a big thing. And just before they climbed onto the bus, he showed it to the group. Quote, I want all of you to remember that the whole purpose of our going is to glorify the name of Christ, to lift up the cross and the message of the cross, the emphasis of the cross, the Christ of the cross, he announced. So we're going to take this cross wherever we go, everywhere. The teenagers looked at one another, a little bit unsure of his plan, but they agreed to it and they dragged the cross onto the bus. It banged back and forth down the aisle all the way to Florida. It went with them into restaurants. It stayed overnight where they stayed overnight. It stood in the sand while they ministered on the beach. You know, at first, lugging the cross around embarrassed the kids. But later, they identified with it. The cross was a constant, silent reminder of who they were and why they had come. They eventually regarded the carrying of it as an honor and a privilege. The night before they went home, the youth leader handed out two nails to each of the kids. He told them that if they wanted to commit themselves to what the cross stood for, they could hammer one nail into it and keep the other with them. And one by one, the teens drove their nail into the cross. About 15 years later, one fellow, now a stockbroker, called the youth leader. He told him that he still keeps that nail with him in his desk drawer. Whenever he loses his sense of focus, he looks at the nail and remembers the cross on that beach in Florida. It reminds him of what is at the core of his life, his commitment to Jesus Christ. Never forget who you were. Never forget who you've been made. Never forget who you serve. And wherever you go and whatever you do, remember whose you are in 2022. And if you do that and you apply these principles, then it will be a successful year for you to live before Jesus and to go out and worship God and make disciples here and around the world. Amen? Let's bow and pray together. Brother Mike, can you come up and just quietly play? I'm not going to ask the people in the cars this morning to get out of their seats and to come in here. I'm not going to ask those at home. Well, at home, you can do whatever you want to. For those of you that are in here today, you can get up and make an altar down here at the front, or you can stay in your seat and do business with God. But here's what I want you to do. If you're willing, I want you to stop and in your own words, from your heart to God's heart, I want you to tell Jesus that you are not interested in the middle of the road. You're not interested in holding hands with Jesus and holding hands with the world at the same time. You do not want to compromise, but you want to be spiritually effective in 2022 by remembering that in Christ, sin shall not have the mastery over you, but you have been set free from sin. And tell the Lord Jesus, I want to be your willing slave. You are my master, and when I wake up every day, I'm going to report in for duty. And I'm going to say, Lord Jesus, who do you want me to talk to today? Show me how to live. Characterize my life by those divine appointments. I am at your service and I am at your disposal. Be Lord over me today. If that's your desire, then guess what? Jesus is going to meet you right where you are, and he's going to take you to a higher level, higher than you've ever been spiritually. And this will be the greatest year. It doesn't matter what's going on in the world. The world is always going to be sick. The world is always going to be messed up. It's always going to be secular. But recognize that there is a difference between you and this culture. Go out and engage it with the power of God on your life. If that's your desire, then spend the next couple of minutes telling your Heavenly Father about it and asking him for the grace that you need to worship God and to make disciples here and around the world.